I think there was an old saying, I don't know who actually said this, but was it during the gold rush? The guys who made all the money were the ones selling the shovels. Well, we are joined here in a very esteemed panel of people selling shovels of all types and investors behind such businesses as well. We'll probably spend about 20, 30 minutes on questions that I've prepared and discussed with the panelists, but if there are any other questions from the audience, we do want to make time for that as well. I thought we'd start off by first asking Anupam, who is an investor with Nokia Growth Partners, where are there opportunities for facilitators? What are the different segments that facilitators can play within the e-commerce realm?
Sure, yeah. good afternoon, everyone. And so I think as you put it nicely, Nitin, I think the picks and shovel opportunity in e-commerce and across, I would say, more broadly across the marketplaces that are coming across, you know, local commerce and e-commerce. That's quite interesting to us, and we have a number of investments around that area globally. So I think broadly laying out, I think, a few areas which are quite interesting. I think one is on the intersection of, or rather in the broader marketing technology space and really applying data to, you know, it's a horizontal within the facilitator ecosystem where you could do pretty much everything that an e-commerce or marketplace firm does, looking at it and, you know, utilizing data to do those things better. So whether it is new customer acquisition, customer retention, loyalty, increasing your customer conversion rates, increasing the propensity to buy, you know, segmenting your customers better, targeting them, all of those things. I think there's this immense amount of potential there, and the amount of, I think what's also happened there is, I think with the advent of mobile and most of the shopping now happening over smartphones, the amount of data that you have about customers has only increased. You have their, you know, oftentimes you have their location, you have, you know, their patterns, the, you know, apps have access to much more data about those customers. So being able to utilize that, I think gives you many different opportunities across different, you know, facilitators to be able to apply that, whether it is within the company or within the, you know, e-commerce company or outside. And then I think there's a number of, we have an eminent panel here. I think we have a number of other, you know, opportunities, whether it's payments, whether it is logistics as a service, different parts of the logistics spectrum, shipping, warehousing, or building other SaaS-based tools for solving some of those problems, bringing together sellers and buyers on these marketplaces, I think is a interesting
spectrum. Absolutely, and you know, you mentioned, of course, affiliate marketing, loyalty, ad networks, anything driving traffic or helping e-commerce merchants analyze that traffic and quality of that traffic. Of course, you mentioned payments and logistics, and we're going to talk about that soon because we have these entrepreneurs here. One area that we as Warburg are also been interested in focusing on are things like data centers, infrastructure, essentially the plumbing behind the internet. To what extent are there opportunities for local players there as well, which, you know, could create some interesting spaces for entrepreneurs to participate. Just moving into you know, the entrepreneur's point of view, I thought it would be useful to just start off with this question of, you know, when is the right time for companies to outsource versus provide these services in-house? And when they outsource, in some cases they may always outsource, how do they start thinking about the right time to work with specific e-commerce focused service providers? Vasu, why don't we start with you on the payment side?
I think compared to other parts of the value chain in terms of what e-commerce companies could outsource, payments is relatively more mature today. So I think from just that perspective, it's almost a no-brainer to say that the day you start, you outsource payments. If the business, whatever be the business you're building, that's core to what you want to do, payments is not what you want to do, and therefore it just absolutely makes sense to outsource it. But at a broader level, from what I've seen of companies, or what I believe at least they should do, is that you outsource what you're not best at or what you're not competent at, given that you have a different focus. If you begin with a complete white canvas and say, I will do whatever comes my way, that's one way to kind of build your business. The other way is to say that this is what I'm going to build, this is what I want to build, this is what I'm going to be good at, and I have the opportunity to outsource these parts of the remaining part of my work to experts in the field. That's when you outsource, that first part. It outsourcing is also dependent upon, are there people to whom you could outsource? So if you go back 5 years ago, if people wanted to outsource logistics for a moment, they may not have had too much of a choice. Today they possibly have. So one is a function of what you want to outsource, and are there enough people to whom you could outsource? The last point I want to mention when companies think of outsourcing is that we work with two kinds of players, e-commerce and non-e-commerce. And I think one of the key distinctive factors that I want to mention is there's a way to think of outsourcing of either as you're outsourcing to a vendor or you're outsourcing to a partner. And that can make a significant difference to how you make these choices and how you live with those choices.
Well, in payment specifically, many of the larger e-commerce companies have, while they've of course outsourced payments, they've decided to work directly with banks. Some e-commerce companies have said, okay, why don't we work with third-party providers as opposed to building direct relationships with each bank for each card product. Any insight as to how companies should be thinking about, okay, do I want to build these direct relationships myself? It has similar repercussions or implications to companies thinking about building direct relationships with regional trucking companies or regional logistics companies as opposed to working with one service provider who can sort of manage their entire sort of nationwide requirements.
If you think of payments and e-commerce companies, India specifically at least, I don't think too many e-commerce companies have managed to do anything successfully with banks. It's always been an aspect. It would be an aspiration to control as much part of the value chain as a company directly can. But at a broader level, I think every single e-commerce company, whether they, from the payments perspective, has always outsourced payments. In the Indian context specifically, the part that the larger players handle them to a great extent is the cash on delivery part, purely because there haven't been any great outsourcing options there. Within the electronic payment part, and historical, even if you look back at 8-9 years ago when the OTAs came into the market, linked to options of co-branding options with banks, especially if you're doing something with a financial product like a card, there are one or two relations they'll always work on. But when you think of the gamut of payments and look at what part do they choose to do directly versus what they outsource, by the sheer quantum of what they outsource, that's always larger than what they would choose to do directly.
That's fair. Samay, you work, you started Gray Orange Robotics. You're actually building solutions and products for both e-commerce companies as well as e-commerce facilitators. What has been your learnings and your insight with respect to when companies decide to build these capabilities, whether it's warehousing services or delivery capabilities in-house, or whether they've chosen to outsource? What have you learned from your interactions with these e-commerce companies or with the delivery companies themselves?
I would actually for that. I would continue with what Vasu said, and that's very right, as it's very dependent on what ecosystem exists. So 7-8 years ago, there was no ecosystem, and that's the reason most of the big players actually went out and started making their own delivery arms and the whole gamut of services. Whereas as these enablers and are coming out in the market, I've seen that most of the people are very open to actually engage with these players as long as they're not linked with a competitor company or so. As long as they're neutral players, people are still very open to actually outsource most of these things, which they don't think is core to their business. So I would say that way, outsourcing is now not that trivial, that not to outsource is not that tough a question for both the big and the small players. Some of the small players, when you come to, I think delivery, if you break up, we serve both the warehousing segment and the delivery segment with our products. If you break up the warehousing part separately, I think warehousing is still something which stays very much inside and is not that outsourced because they don't reach scale to be able to have shared facilities, etc. And neither do our taxation and government policies allow for that.
That's actually a very interesting point. So there's this regulatory issue as well as a scale issue, because you can always create a multi-user warehousing facility serving multiple clients. But the regulatory issue you still think is driving that? Or does that change with GST?
It's not changed yet. So for example, right now you cannot mix multiple vendor goods. Now that you, all the efficiencies that you gain in warehousing by having a multi-user facility are not there to take right now because the regulatory bodies don't allow you to do that yet. And if you look at this, it's a very legal tussle as to what's gray and what is not. So that's where outsourcing on the warehousing side is still very less, whereas the delivery space is fairly open. And companies actually choose to use multiple partners to have better coverages across different geographies.
So we're actually seeing a spectrum of maturity in outsourcing across industries, starting with payments, where there's been a fair amount of emergence of many third-party players. On delivery, you're seeing it now. Warehousing still to come, and that of course brings us to packaging, where Aditya, maybe you could share some of what your findings are. And I guess the choice that companies are making, to put it into context, is do I work with the local mom and pop unorganized packaging service provider, or do I work with a specialized service provider who can meet my needs as an e-commerce company?
So there are three major points I want to cover in this point. One, as you just said, about should you go for local manufacturers or people who are geared to actually serve e-commerce companies. Now, when you select your packaging material, there are many aspects which you need to look into before you actually go in for a particular type of packaging. Do you take security features in the bag, such as do you want a barcode on it? Do you want double seals on it? All these things add security to your packages. So all the news that we hear about packages getting tampered on the way or pilfered on the way, these things are mitigated by going in for the higher end packaging. So when you work with a specialized e-commerce packaging company such as SoundSeal, you have the option of going in for these features. These obviously increase your cost, but
So the story of someone ordering a gold coin and getting a mixer grinder is not an urban legend.
It's not a legend. So I actually have a friend who ordered a gold coin from one of these websites. Instead of a website, he got a mixer grinder. So what happened was someone on the way tampered the bag. So there are two forms of tampering again on this. The bag could be tampered inside the warehouse itself by an employee. So to mitigate such risks, we have developed a custom barcode system. The second is when tampering happens on the way. In such cases, the third-party logistics provider, someone from their company, could tamper with the packaging.
So you actually also raise an interesting point, which I think is relevant for many e-commerce facilitators, which is we can always provide a product, but the product will eventually become a commodity. It's really a function of providing an additional layer of service that's unique to the requirements of these companies. Would Vasu, you or somebody want to comment on that in the case of payments or logistics and warehousing? Or maybe even with respect to what Grey Orange also does?
So I actually just continue on that. Firstly, I definitely think that this is happening. A lot of this, when you get in experts from outside to actually help you with some of your processes, you get an ecosystem knowledge. So for example, gold coin might be a rare one, but we've seen zillions of laptops shipping where they're actually supposed to be toys or under 100 rupee items getting shipped. And these things become, the algorithm just keeps becoming better and better as to, because we've seen this trend for a lot of time. And what I figured out was that it's actually been happening even before e-commerce, but it was such a small segment that people didn't care for. For example, we've seen so many, one of our clients is a logistics player, and we've seen so many televisions missing inside the packaging. The packaging is perfect, it's a huge packaging, but by the time it reaches the end delivery hub or the customer, the only thing missing inside is the television, and it is still weight matched to exactly how much it should be, removing the television. So it's not urban legend. The only thing is that people like us who are enablers for across the market, maybe as you scale, you might see it for the first time, but people like us would have already seen this across the market and can actually get these tools in place much before you have to actually see it or it becomes a big enough problem to solve.
Fair. On the payment side?
Not just payments. I think overall, people apply that in their daily lives. You buy a branded product because it comes with an assurance. Same applies to outsourcing. When you look at an expert in the field, there's obviously the temptation to say that I could also do this, especially if you're a startup and you've got four people, let's say, in the organization. You can say, how much does it take to do packaging? I can hire two guys and it's buy the material. It's a lesser cost than outsourcing. What you're not paying attention to when you make that kind of a decision is what does it actually take to do the job extremely well. And that's the distinction between people who make those right choices versus not. as to what quality will you live with, the one that you can build for yourself is one of the many things that you're doing, versus what you get at the best that's best in the market. I think that's principally where it
is. Could you provide a specific example with respect to payments for many e-commerce entrepreneurs who are here? You know, what are those areas of focus that they should have?
So in a way, I'll give a very simple example. I don't know if it kind of makes the point that I want to make. Payments logically are areas that banks are supposed to be best at, and they've been doing this for decades or maybe even centuries. But globally, and not just in India, banks have figured that they are great at banking, but payments itself is outsourceable, right? I mean, and that's one example in and of itself. And that should be a good enough indicator for any company which would believe that you could enter into payments as one more thing that you want to do. Specific as examples, we serve, as I said, both e-commerce and non-e-commerce segments. There was a point in time when the largest banks in India used to handle payments for large clients directly, which means, and this is, let's say, just the pre-large e-commerce players. So if you looked at the largest banks, they used to work with regular companies like, let's say, Vodafone and Airtel, the regular companies. Banks used to work directly with for payments. And as payments evolved, these were natural choices that entities like a Vodafone or an Airtel made to say that there is a better expertise which is available with the narrow niche of payments players. And the same realization with banks to say that I do multiple things and payments is just one part of it. Even I'm better advantaged to serving my customer if I do payments. So in the Indian context, examples of both, I think in the non-e-commerce there are a lot many more examples because that's a more mature market. Within e-commerce, I think there are fairly public examples of companies wanting to do payments and then deciding that there's better value in focusing in what they're building than to want to do payments. Because over the years, one would have seen multiple announcements of people say, I also want to do payments, I also want to do my own logistics and delivery. But those have come down as a...
Yep, that's fair. Yep.
I would like to add to this. There was one e-commerce company, so they're one of the biggest in India today. So they actually approached machine manufacturers, asking them if they can make the packaging material themselves. What happens is it's not only buying the machine, it's the whole setup cost involved in it, and then actually running the machine with the actual features of the bag. So although it might look rosy on the outside, oh, I'll be saving X amount of money, when you actually go to do it, you will be losing more money. So the decision whether you want to do it in-house or outsource it is requires a lot of thinking before you actually take the plunge, especially for something which is capital intensive as manufacturing.
This is an open question, have you found that as these companies have scaled, there has been a tendency for them to bring more of these services in-house or control a greater portion of these services or focus on their core business and outsource more of these non-core services? I'll keep this open for anyone. I don't know if some of you have a point of view on that.
Sure, I can go for it. So I would say one is that most of the cases when they want to bring it back in is cases where they're fed up with the outsourcing. So I would say that's one very easy indicator of, you know, let's get it back in because I've tried and I've gone through this, but at the end of the day, if it's easier to build it ourselves because I did try, right? Yeah. So you have that. The second thing I'll add to this is that, you know, as you scale or no matter what size you are in a company, there are only a restricted number of people who are the right people to handle new initiatives and solve problems, right? So if it is something as a choice where it's easily outsourceable, I'm much more happier. I'm sure most of the big or small companies don't want to put their key people behind things which they can easily outsource because they also have, at the end, human capital is going to be the constraint in most of them. So I would say they're happy outsourcing as long as they're not fed up of outsourcing.
That's fair.
I just want to leave a thought on about that. Yeah. Just because we've seen different kind of companies
Certainly.
Behave differently. I think clearly when companies outsource and they're fed up and they're bringing it back in, it primarily it reflects that ecosystem of whatever they outsource doesn't exist, right? Because they're not switching to another, but they're pulling it back in. And that would be typically where there's only one particular, let's say, provider there. But historically and philosophically, companies outsource when they're fed up with the way their internal teams are handling. You outsource because saying, look, as an organization, I can do better if that part of the piece was handled better. And I think there is a value in outsourcing. So, and I'm just taking it beyond e-commerce too. You'd have the largest Fortune 500 company saying, let's get a, just as a name, a McKinsey to consult for us. Much as we know the industry better, there's still a value to outsourcing. So there are multiple cases of how people think of outsourcing. But on what I think goes, a critical factor that happens in the outsourcing is how people think of the cost, to the point that got made. It's very easy to be able to put a price to the outsourcing, but not being able to put a cost to handling it on your own. Because outsourcing is very variable. To say, I pay you X for Y delivery, so the X is very quantifiable. When you bring it in, the X is nebulous. You're not able to put a cost to what's the, how do you ascribe a cost to the bandwidth that goes into that, your resources that go, the real estate that goes. People always miscalculate that. And that's the key part of it.
Isn't there also a thesis, like an ethos amongst technology companies that, you know, this is part of the customer experience, or there is some data associated with providing this product or service, and we don't want to relinquish that customer experience. We don't, I mean, Amazon's a great example of that. They have sort of famously not outsourced many types of services that we typically see outsourced here in India.
I agree. What is core to the business, they should not outsource, because then you're just, what are you building?
Then it just comes down to what do you define core. So that's fair. So, you know, I think that this is an interesting conversation and insights for e-commerce entrepreneurs thinking about what partnerships they want to build with facilitators. I want to change the tone of the conversation now. If there are any budding e-commerce facilitators starting new businesses in this area, the question that I have for this panel is e-commerce a good business to chase? Should you build a business, you know, selling picks and shovels to e-commerce merchants? How do you think about that? I mean, there are customer concentration issues because Snapdeal, Flipkart, and, you know, Amazon are the large customers. There are questions around, you know, is this real? Is this growth really going to play out as people expect? Can you invest behind it? You know, maybe you can, and, you know, they're famous for squeezing vendors. Any insights there?
I'll take that one. This is particularly true in our case. So what has happened is in the last 1 or 2 years, the demand has surged from the e-commerce companies. What is happening in our industry is the moment demand surges, we need to make new investments. We can't really outsource the process because the technology is patented. So what is happening right now is we are investing heavily in machinery because of the surging demand. But the question that hangs around us is, again, is the demand real, which is true. Currently, I would say yes. In the short run, we are very, very happy with the e-commerce companies. The margins have gone down definitely with the increase in volumes, but the payment cycles are relatively better than the other industries. At the same time, we hedge ourselves since we provide our solutions to across industries, such as banks and exports as well. So we are de-risking, but the main volume drivers today are the e-commerce industries.
But there's a certain amount of hedging you can do by working with other types of customers as well.
As I said, certainly. So banks, education industries, yeah, is where we work as well.
Absolutely.
So I think it's definitely a good customer industry on the first front, which it's young, nascent. I mean, not just India, globally, it's a 15, 20 year old industry. It's a niche. They're growing like crazy. So problems are not well documented where you say, okay, this is the problem, let's get expert in, solve, take 6 months to solve it, because in 3 months the problem changes. So I think from that definition, it's probably the ideal customer to have. And if you have ambitions of growing as fast as they are growing, you cannot grow without having the customer also growing, right? But having said that, do you, as you scale in a business, probably initially it's okay to stay very focused on e-com, grow the initial mile, but I think de-risking both in terms of industry and de-risking in terms of both geography makes a lot of sense, because I mean, I fundamentally believe e-com is here to stay globally, right? Whether the India one is a bubble, whether it'll take another 5 years to reach those peaks on average is up for debate. But is e-com headed towards an industry? Is it going to be another mode of purchasing? I think that's going to be true. So I think just de-risking as a business, as you do whenever you hit a little scale, is obvious. But otherwise, it's a good industry to have as customers.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with most points made that when you build a business, you're building it for a market. In theory, for example, if you're building a billing solution for a telecom company, you may not have too many opportunities. You can't start building a product which will work both for telecom and, let's say, for an e-commerce, right? You make certain choices depending on the client segment you're going to address. So for any for a startup or a facilitator, can they just focus on e-commerce in India and do it? I think absolutely yes. Because as it will take many years before somebody's going to come to a decision of was it a worthwhile industry or not. It's at least a 5-10 year out thing. So it's definitely worthwhile building for the e-commerce industry. But what I've seen people kind of stumble a bit upon there, especially when startups come up, is that they build a solution or a product keeping the largest e-commerce companies in mind in terms of the way they think of the business. I have a great solution which will change the way the dynamics of a certain part of the large e-commerce companies work, and I can get this scale of business from them, and therefore this is worthwhile doing it. From just business and economics perspective, that may not necessarily be the right way to think of it. For a startup, I think the challenge is to say that if I go to the large e-commerce player, I'm going to get scale. But at the same time, I'm going to get squeezed. It's something that the large e-commerce company can potentially build by itself. There's greater value in thinking of the solution that I have. Can I parallelly or in priority go to the set of people who need me more than me needing the larger guy?
Absolutely. Last question that I'll ask, and then we'll open up to the floor, so do have your questions ready. Question is to the investor, Anubhav. So in your view, if you are evaluating business models of e-commerce facilitators, what in your view is what it takes to win? And what are the attractive investment opportunities or business characteristics? We've talked about the segments, but within those segments, what do these businesses have to exhibit in order for you to be confident as an investor to take the plunge?
Sure, yeah, and that's obviously a very broad area, and it varies a lot by a specific type of facilitator. And but I think really, actually also relating it back to your previous question on, in-house versus outsourcing, I think there really needs to be a, core area or competence where it makes sense for a function to be done as part of a third-party facilitator versus being done in-house. And I'll take some examples. E-commerce company can go build a payments engine, sure. They can go build a Omniture or Google Analytics, sure. But it makes much more sense for there to be a third-party engine which caters to many other players, because either there's a cost angle to it, or there's a network effect to it, and so on. So I think there has to be an element like that. And
so you do your due diligence, you do your channel checks, you speak to 5 e-commerce companies. Each of them tell you this is a pain for us to do it in-house. We want to get this off our books and outsource. That's step one. I completely agree with you. Then after that, right.
Yeah. So I think like a lot of other so a lot of the characteristics would be quite similar to what you would want to see in any other business, B2B type businesses. You want to understand, is the product really meeting this need? Is it, what's the stickiness of this product? What's the, who are the competitors? Some of these spaces are, fairly competitive with, not a very high barrier to entry. Whereas some niches, the barrier to entry is very high for a new facilitator to come in. And so I think that aspect gets very important. And then I think it's hard to sell to these clients and manage them. These are tough taskmasters, and they're growing very fast themselves, and there's a lot of movement all over the place. So you have to be able to fulfill the needs of these clients and keep them happy. So I think that aspect is gets really important as well. So really, when we are doing diligence, the one really important part is just really talking to several of the clients and understanding the how things have gone so far.
Are there network effects in the facilitation business? You do see network effects in e-commerce businesses, many-to-many aspects, the more buyers, the more seller, et cetera. Do you see that in some of these ancillary industries?
Yeah, we do. I think, and just to take some examples, take logistics as a service, for instance, right? I think it makes, from a just cost perspective, there's a significant network effect in there being, some unified logistics networks like FedEx or UPS in the US versus 15 e-commerce companies and 15 retailers each building their having their own trucks and warehouses is different, but having their own trucks and guy going to the door every door in the locality, that's one example of a network effect. Or take the data and analytics business. There's very high network effects there. There's only so much so versus compared to again, 15 e-commerce companies and 15 retailers trying to build their own hyper-targeting engine. And some of them will do it, but I think a third-party company can be better geared to do it just from a perspective of being able to see so many different sorts of data.
Have a repository.
So I think that's another kind of network effect. So I think that exists in a lot of these verticals, and I think there's a fair bunch of that in payments as well, where you have so many different banks and sources of payments,
right.
And you know, you have so many different e-commerce companies. For every e-commerce company to try and connect with every bank and every credit card and every debit card and every source of payment is more tedious than you know a couple of payment gateway companies doing it. So
we ended early. Thank you very much for participating in this panel. Thank you, TechCircle, for bringing us all together.